This is the Realty Classroom Podcast, episode number 6.
Welcome to the show that focuses on helping real estate agents build a bulletproof business plan so that they can sell more properties in less time and live a more fulfilled life.
Are you a real estate agent with an entrepreneurial spirit who wants to turn your job into a business without sacrificing your lifestyle, but you just can't seem to find the right plan to help you get there? Well, then you're definitely in the right place. I'm Danny Griffin, the founder of the Realty Classroom and the host of this podcast. And to help you take immediate action to build a better real estate agent business, whether you're a veteran or a rookie, I've created a free jumpstart course for you over at freeagentgift.com. In this episode, I have to go backwards one episode and say last time we covered how does the real estate agent business really work? And we delved into MLS. And what does MLS stand for? A multiple listing service. And I implored you to go study the MLS and what it really means. But I want to dive into it a little bit more with today's topic, which is don't ignore the sellers. I know that sounds a little bit funny, but I'm going to say it again. Don't ignore the sellers. See, seller listings are the backbone of our business. Think about what MLS stands for. Multiple, that means a lot of them, listings. Multiple listings, system, service, whatever you want to call it, MLS is the marketplace. And that's similar to the stock market. What's in the stock market? Stocks, bonds, etc. Anything that can trade that's a financial instrument is in the marketplace. That's where things happen. The bond market, the equity market, whatever it might be. Why do we consider real estate any different? Because when you really look at it, we have this massive individual asset that's being traded. An individual house or condominium or land, it's a big one thing, one item, right? Whereas stocks are more of, we don't really see them the same way. It's a piece of paper that once upon a time was actually traded back and forth. These days, it's all just done electronically. So there's no physical attachment to it. So we don't really see these marketplaces as the same, but they are. And they work very similarly. So the emphasis here is on the listings. And that's why I say don't ignore the sellers, because seller listings, my first point here, are the backbone of the entire business. So I found early on in my career and when I coach, it's just easier to default to go do buyer business. I remember having the stack of business cards and I'd be out with them. And if somebody started talking about real estate, I'd just dive in that conversation and say, I can find you that. And I just wasn't in tuned to the frequency of listings because nobody really hammered this simple message down to me. And it just seemed like, look, I don't have any experience. So the easiest thing to do is help somebody find a listing inside the MLS. Go around, look at properties, zero in from the outer ring of the bullseye, and bang, I have a business. And it was, to me, I really thought guaranteed business. But when, and I'll probably get in trouble here with some of you all, you exclusive buyer agency folks right now, and I don't mean to insult your business model. I'm just saying what I suddenly recognized was, well, wait a minute, with a listing, I have the opportunity to then subsequently find more buyers. We all love, as listing agents, the double-ended deal when somebody comes directly. And I'm finding in the digital age, that's happening more and more as they come directly to the listing agent. I just tell you right now, there's no arguing that a listing is the max leverage on the buy versus the sell side. There's no doubt about it. You just can't argue it away. So let's just accept that as a fact of the marketplace, that seller listings are the backbone. And it's a really good idea, whether you're a rookie or a veteran, to pay very close attention to acquiring them. And that leads me to the next point here, that even top producers like me and a lot of the friends that I have in this business, a lot of times we list by accident. And what I mean by that is, sure, we have ways that we market and there are things that we do to attract a seller lead or get a listing, but oftentimes it's nowhere near as strategic an approach as it could be. A lot of people that are top producers or really good boutique companies or even national conglomerates that attract listings do it based on brand alone. So I would also say to all you veterans out there and top producers, stop getting your listings by accident. A lot of you will say, well, it was just referred to me and it came that way. Well, even with referrals, there are all sorts of ways to be extremely intentional about talking to your referral sources or your sphere of influence, anybody that can bring you a listing or a listing conversation or a seller conversation, you have to be intentional and stop doing that by accident. It's a very, very key point here. The next point is about my brother, Johnny Boy. John Griffin, when he first started in the business, looked like he was probably about 15 years old. So I know, and I had coaxed him out of coming out of the commercial real estate industry to join me in this endeavor. And when John came over, like I said, he looked really young. So it was very easy to tee the ball up for John with those buyers. And again, remember back then, I'm not as intentional about listings as I am today. So it made sense. I would get overflow buyer appointments, give them to John and other team members, and those guys would just do a killer job servicing them. But when it came to the psychology of being confident enough to walk into a home up against veterans or good listing agents and compete, it was very easy to feel insecure for all of us. And I always remember John saying, but they're so savvy. This seller is savvy. And I said, well, what do you mean by the fact that he's savvy? Well, he's a doctor. Oh, really? So he opens up people's bodies every day, I suppose, and he's savvy at fixing them. But why is he savvy at real estate? And why is he more savvy than you? Because he sold what? You know, you hear this all the time as an agent. Well, I've sold X number of houses in my life. Okay, great. I mean, you've never approached it as a professional. You're not a licensed real estate agent. You don't do this. You don't study this. So great. You what? FSBO did, or you were involved with an agent. What does that mean? That doesn't make you savvy. What makes somebody savvy is the studying and then the doing of the thing and making the distinctions and refining it. And at this point in time in John's career, he'd done a bunch of that. He'd work with the very thing or the people that the sellers needed, buyers. So he was an expert at what buyers wanted and what they needed and how they dealt with sellers. He knew the whole side of that. So the big thing here to get over this psychological block is stop thinking that the seller knows more than you do. Forget about the competition for a minute. Let's just focus on the seller. They don't know more than you do if you're a studied agent. Sure, brand new out of the box agent who has very little education on this podcast or wherever else you're trying to learn. Okay, great. Maybe somebody who sold a couple homes is out in front of you, but you can be resourceful and bring a partner in from your brokerage, somebody who has done it before and learn. But better yet, I'm going to help you and John overcome the savvy seller trap. And that's to start with a simple solution. You don't need to know a whole bunch about listing a property other than what you're already doing. And look, here we are again. The multiple listing service is there for you. That's the first place to start. As an agent, you paid for access to that. Go in there and study it. Study what goes on in there. So you all of a sudden are becoming more savvy than the seller who thinks they know that. They don't have access to the marketplace like you do. So now you're in there and you're looking at what sold around them. You're looking at the history of that property. Did it need price reductions? How did it sell versus its competitors? You can look at the pictures to see if it was staged or not, what kind of condition it was in. You could drive by and see its exact locations. You are savvy. You are savvy. So even the simplest solutions of being able to express to a seller what's gone on in the marketplace around them and how it affects them is a fabulous place to start. Now, down the line, certainly I'm going to get into a deeper dive into that simple solution. But suffice to say, I want you to begin to think about it from the marketplace outwards as we dive in on these podcast episodes and teach you a little bit more about the details of each phase of listing and selling a property, right? So a simple solution to understand how that will work in MLS. And of course, the simple things that you would have to do. Get professional pictures, present that the best it can be in the marketplace. Go above and beyond to that extent. Don't be lazy. Don't just take some haphazard pictures. Get in there. Have the, you know, the staging, et cetera, all those things. And I don't want to go too far into it right at the moment. Just be ready for MLS, okay? That's your simple solution to start with. So let's chunk this back up. Number one, the key point of this episode is that you should learn how to master acquiring and selling listings. And that's speaking to the rookie right out of the box. Don't worry about anything else other than that. You just got to get after it. It's a part of the business and it's not going away. Now for you veterans, as I said, don't be doing this by accident. So let's chunk these points up. Number one, don't ignore the sellers. Two, seller listings are the backbone of our entire business. So if you ignore them at your own peril and lose the leverage that they give you. And it's fabulous leverage. Three, even top producers, you're listing by accident too much out there. Be intentional, whether that's being referred to you or these are internet leads that you're converting. I don't care what the source is. Be more intentional about making that happen regularly. And Johnny Griffin, when you're out there listening to this, tell them anybody can get beyond the savvy seller trap, right? That's the key point. Get beyond that. That's a mindset thing. We are the pros. We need to act like it right from the very start. And how do you do that? You present a very clear, simple solution, which starts with an understanding of how the multiple listing service really works and what you're going to do to present them through that marketplace better than anybody else. Great place to start. A lot more to talk about, but a great place to start for all of us to get rerouted. Remember, you can take immediate action and get started in the right direction or maybe a better direction with our free video course over at freeagentgift.com. Of course, if you like what you've learned here, then we'd really appreciate it if you would subscribe and help us share these insights by giving us a positive review on whichever platform you're listening so that other entrepreneurial real estate agents just like you can find their way here to join us. So thanks for listening, and we look forward to helping you in the next episode.
You've been listening to The Realty Classroom with Danny Griffin. Join us next time to continue learning how to build a smarter real estate agent business plan that helps you live a more fulfilled life.